wonder if Sheikh Ahmed Deedat, you met actually Dongan. You said you went to Sudan and you tried to meet him.
Yes.
And coming from the challenge to come from in South Africa,
Sheikh,
of Muslims being a minority, what do you think of the other challenge we meet in Sudan of Muslims being the majority, and yet they are in war with the others for some 35 years? And also, coming from Sudan as you did a few months ago, what do you think of a Muslim minority party, like the National Islamic Party, coming to power in a country like Sudan through a coup d'etat, and then butchering and torturing its political enemies, Muslims and everybody else, you know, and trying to sort out the problem of the South through violence and through war? What do you think of all this?
Brother, I am a man of religion. I am a da'i, a propagator of Islam. I am not a politician. But that doesn't mean that I can't make suggestions to you all. About the rights and wrongs of this party and that party, I don't understand. I have to go and study in depth, you know, the different parties, what they're doing, what not, what is legitimate, what is not legitimate. That is not my role. But what I can suggest, as I suggested to your people, I take it you are a Sudanese, from your turban, I make it out. You know. So I did suggest to the people there, I said, look, we are at war. We are at war with the South. And inshallah, I hope and pray, because you are my brothers, that may Allah give you success. That's a natural feeling I have. But I said, you can win the war, but you might lose the peace. Peace you will not lose. So I said, to win the peace, you have to win the hearts of people. Change them, make them your own. When our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he set his sacred feet in Medina, the Aus and the Khajraj, the two tribes in Medina, two families or tribes, they were on the verge of exterminating one another. Exterminating one another. Our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he set his sacred feet in Medina, and he gave them Hablillah. Allah says, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعُوا وَلَا تَفَرَّكُوا إِذْ كُنْتُمْ عَدَعًا فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَةِ إِخْوَانًا. He says, and remember, وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَىٰ شَفَا حُفْرَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ, and you were on the brink of the pit of fire, فَأَنْكَذَكُمْ مِّنْهَا, and Allah saved you from it. I said, right, we are also on the brink of the pit of fire. We want to exterminate one another. So now, I said, now we have to learn to talk to the person. We have to learn to talk. Have you learned a word you can utter in his language? A word? Can you say salams to him in his language? Peace? Can you? And I found my Muslim brothers, not only in Sudan, all over the world. Same sickness. We are an arrogant people. Now I have to tell you that. We will not learn the language of the native. You don't want to learn his language. You haven't done it, and you won't do it. The white man comes from 10,000 miles away, and he masters the native's language, and he writes a book in his language, and he gives it to him. They have the Bible in 40 different Sudanese languages, southern Sudan. 40 different languages. And four, I said, for the Dinkas alone. Four different dialects of the Dinkas. I didn't know all this. I'm reading a book, Sudan, the Christian Design, by some Hassan Makki of Khartoum. I'm asking there in the Sudan, anybody has got the book? I go to the Islamic bookshop, the book is not available. Anybody? Nobody. You haven't read the book. The Buddhists. They are respectable people, respectful people. They respect human beings. The Buddhists. Amazing. Now I'm asking, so look, these people are there with you. Have you learned to say good morning to him in his language? The Chinese, you want to say good morning to him in his language? The pig eaters, the wine bibbers. You giggle. It's a giggling thing. In Singapore, I said, the guys are ruling you now. It was a part of Malaysia. I don't know whether you know. Singapore was Malaysia. When the British left, they left that system of democracy, counting of heads. And they counted the heads. There were more Chinese heads than Malay heads. So the Chinese came into power. There are now over 2 million, and you are half a million, the Malays. And till doomsday, you can never catch up. For every 10 Chinese that are born, only 2 Malays are born. So you don't even work hard enough in that field. Damn it all. I said, you have no chance, no hope. Have you learned to say good morning to him in his language? No, it's a joke. I said, look, the guy's going to rule you for eternity, man, till Yawm al-Qiyamah. At least learn to say good morning, learn to live with him. No. It's a shame for him to learn his language. I says, you know, learn to say salams to him in his language. Do you know how to say salams to him in his language? You know what he says? Allah says, وَإِذَا حُيِّتُمْ بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّ بِأَحْسَنُ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّهَا. If somebody offers you a courteous greeting, offer him something better or at least something equal. He doesn't say Muslim or non-Muslim. Anybody who offers you a courteous greeting, you offer him something better or at least something equal, Allah says. The man says, Salaamu Alaikum. We ought to say, Wa Alaikum Salaam Wa Rahmatullahi Wa Barakatuh. But I'm too busy. I haven't got the time. You haven't got the time. At least you can say Wa Alaikum Salaam. You say Salaamu Alaikum, say Wa Alaikum Salaam. At least you can say that, Allah says. But see if you can do better. The Chinese, can you wish him? Nobody. Nobody. I can't find one Muslim in Malaysia. So 30% of your people are Chinese. You do business with them, you work for them, and you can't say Salaamu Alaikum in their language? No. So I went to an university. I want to find out, what do they say, the Chinese? How do they wish one another? The Malays don't know. I don't know whether the Sudanese Muslim know how to say salams to the Dinka. How do you say? We say in the Zulu saga, Boana. If there are more than we say San Boana. We know, we say the white man we meet, the African, we say Khoimora, Khoinand. We learn the guy's language, man. A salutation, it opens the guy's heart, he softens up towards you, if you can wish him in his language. You know what the Chinese say? The Cantonese Chinese. The first, one of the Sahabas of our Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he went to China and he is buried there in Canton. Sahaba! Buried in Canton. Islam reached China 500 years before it reached India. India is nearer, but Islam reached China 500 years before it reached India. You have to explain why. Why? I'm telling the Malays, you don't have to go to China. China has come to you. Damn it all, talk to him, man. You know what the Chinese say? When they meet one another, the Cantonese Chinese, where the Sahaba is buried, that area, they say, Sik Cho Fan Mie. Sik Cho Fan Mie. You know what they say? Have you eaten? Have you eaten? That's a salutation. Have you eaten? No, they know what hunger is. We Muslims ought to know, we fast for one whole month. But we don't realize what hunger is. We don't, it's a routine, ritual we go through. The Chinese knows what hunger is. So every time he meets a person, says, have you eaten? If you haven't, whatever is there, come, sit down, eat. I want to review with some clever guys here, see if you can better that. That's the humility, the compassion that he has for human beings. But he's a Chinese, chinky, you know, he's going to go to hell, he's a pig eater and a wine bibber. Learn, man, learn to humble yourself, win people's hearts.